Hello and welcome to another edition of Journalist Hangout. I am Veronica Danikpoy. Today on Journalist Hangout, Senate refuses to confirm Ibrahim Magu as EFCC chairman. President Muhammadu Buhari presents 7 trillion naira 2017 budget, says it will end recession. Later on the program, court orders EFCC to unfreeze Governor Fayose's bank accounts. I'm being joined by Shola Ojeosi. Thanks for joining us. And we have Babajide Kolade Otitoju. Thanks for coming on the show. And we have Gani Kayode Balogun, GKB. Thanks for coming on Journalist.
It's a pleasure.
Hangout. Journalist Hangout starts now. The Senate has rejected the nomination of Ibrahim Magu as the chairman of the Economic and Financial Commission, EFCC. The Senate says its decision was based on security report made available to it. Ibrahim Magu was to be screened today, 5 months after President Buhari wrote to the Senate seeking its approval. What is going on? I'll start with you, Shola. 5 months after the Senate for the presidency asked for approval, and now you're coming out to say that there is a security report and we are rejecting this person. Is there more to this beyond what we already or what we know?
Well, people have been
aware right from the start that perhaps there are some undercurrents going on beyond the idea of coming up with this issue of a security report or whatever.
Undercurrents, what do you mean?
In the sense of people have been wondering if considering some of the problems of specific officials of government or people in the Senate having issues one way or the other with the EFCC, whether this man that has been the arrowhead of all these prosecutions will really be able to skate through. But what I can just say here is that, I mean, no matter what, it's within the constitutional right of the National Assembly to be able to confirm or otherwise not do it. So whether it takes time or not, we cannot overlook. Because when you're talking in terms of security, or if there are certain security reports or whatever from whoever is behind that, then that cannot be an event to be overlooked. But why I was mentioning the issue of undercurrent initially, is it actually the thing behind this? Or are there specific personal things?
Is there more to this, GKB, you're smiling, I'm wondering, is there more to this than we know?
Well, when it comes to the issue of this government, at every level, the level of incompetence is galling. For example, a major appointment of the president, that the party controls the Senate and the House of Reps, at this level, is not something we should be discussing 18 months after the fact. But it's a reflection of the lack of cohesion, lack of synergy between the Senate on one hand and the border administration on the other. Because like I said, this was done 5 months ago. July 14, the letter was read. Normally, this would take about 90 days tops. Now, we are 5 months down the line, and he's not going to get it. Of course, the president has the right to represent his name or continue to put him in active capacity for a limited period. But as the political fallout of this, that the president, just like he said on the first day, is not for anybody, and it's for nobody. And the Senate has taken the moves by the horn. And it's not the first, it's going to be the first in a long leg of rejections. Don't forget the one about the ambassadors.
Really?
Don't forget the one about board members. And they've shown that they have the teeth, and they are willing to use it.
All right, we come to you, Abanjide. What is your take on this matter right now? What is this security report that we never heard of until today?
The president appointed Ibrahim Magu on November 9, 2015. That means it's already more than a year that Magu has been EFCC chairman in acting capacity. Why did it take so long for a security report to be generated? Ordinarily, the security report should have come even before the appointment. At the point when the president is headhunting, the president will let the security agencies know that these are the people that he wants to appoint into key positions. And if there are skeletons in the cupboards of those individuals, the security agencies will go to work before the president goes to town, you know, with that person's name, before the president officially appoints that person. That is the way it's supposed to be. Now, we have a very hostile Senate, a very corrupt Senate. It is difficult to not believe that there is some mischief, you know, playing out at this stage. Of course, with the connivance of some people within within the presidency itself, because we have a situation in which the National Security Advisor says he is unaware of the security report. So we are talking about synergy within the people who work directly with the president. You will want to expect that the National Security Advisor and the Director of the SSS are among the closest to the president. They have access to him, and they are talking to him all the time. But in a situation in which the National Security Advisor is saying that he's not aware of the security report, but we are being told by the Senate that the security report emanated from the DSS, then what is the content of the security report? They need to let us know what is there. You can accuse Ibrahim Magu of high-handedness, of not respecting procedures, but you cannot say Ibrahim Magu is corrupt. You cannot say Ibrahim Magu is corrupt. This is a man that I've known for more than 10 years. You cannot say that. And if that is what the security report is about, we want Nigerians to be, they need to let Nigerians have the facts. This is what he has done. You cannot just say, okay, you are not going to confirm this fellow because you have a security report that you have not let the rest of us know about. The rest of us Nigerians deserve to know the content of this security report. Because if we are saying corruption has done so much damage to our country, we need someone that Nigerians can trust. Just recently, he was promoted Deputy Commissioner of Police. So if it was that bad, why was he promoted? Why didn't this security report count against him at the time? So we were in a country in which so many funny things happen. What I want to see in the coming days is whether the president actually supports what is going on. Because if he does not support what is going on, because this is the first time that somebody will be nominated to this kind of position, and that I know that the DSS would now say that person is not, has some security report. Now, if the president thinks that this is the best person that he can find at this time for this job, then I will advise him to leave Ibrahim Magu in acting capacity, because even in acting capacity, he can play all the roles of the EFCC chairman. The only thing is when it will not be, maybe when he's leaving office, he will not get entitlements and other benefits that a substantive EFCC chairman gets. But he can play that role to the best of his ability, even in acting capacity, and he's been doing that.
But one question that bothers the mind of most persons when I went online and all of when I was asking questions around is the fact that the DSS, or rather the SSS and the AFCC, have been working together for some time now, and now you are just coming up with this kind of report. If you knew he was a security risk, why didn't you say immediately, Shola?
Well, I mentioned earlier that, you know, there are undercurrents. You know, it's so sudden. We do not know what they have. But like Jide said, let them come forward and say this is the reason.
Do you think they will come forward with it?
Well, that's the question. But you know, the person we want on that post is somebody who should be above board. And a lot of people have spoken for this man as being at least a reliable.
Looking at how far he has performed, yes. Who do you say he is above board?
Well, in terms of, he might have been, you know, in terms of the procedures, there may be some, maybe, I mean, in terms of speed, but you can vouch for the man's integrity. Yeah. It has been mentioned that he's a man of integrity. But if something is now coming at this late hour, because I consider it a late hour, then there is something fishy. We should not overlook the fact that there are a lot of vested interests. Magu might suddenly have become a very dangerous man. to such people. And the only way they can stop him is to go through this National Assembly process and make sure he's not given the opportunity. But the president still he has a card. And I believe if he really knows his onions and he sees, I mean, between the lines, that definitely there is something more than meet the eye, then he can still play that card given to him constitutionally. First, to get back to what Jide said about at least representing or still making him, I mean, be in the acting position that he has been for quite some time. But we really need to know. Like I said, we want somebody we can trust. So if they have issues, they should let Nigeria know these are the issues and let the people see the reason why a man who has been projected as a very honest person is now being rejected. So we need to have answers, and that's what should happen in the coming days.
All right, I'll come to you, JKB. Jide talked about his high-handedness, and then some persons have come to talk about the way he has been handling certain cases.
His contempt for the
process. Well, we'll talk about that because we need to go on the break now. When we return, we'll look at how he has performed over time. Let's take the break now. You're still watching Journalist Hangout, and we are looking at the rejection of Ibrahim Magu by the Senate. When we were talking before we went on the break, looking at what Jide said, talking about his high-handedness, and then the way he has performed so far in terms of certain cases relating to the judges, and well, let us mention the case of Patience Jonathan and the likes. Yeah. Now, could that... That's one of the questions that has been asked. Could that have been a major factor that is working against his confirmation?
Nigerian, everything works for the self-interest of the people involved. Don't forget, there's never been an EFCC chairman who left the seat without a cloud hanging over their head. No. And I think it's part of the pattern that to work within the context of the rule of law, run into problems with people who are investigating. And in the last 1 year, he has shown the resolve, sometimes over zealousness, of making sure that people answered for crimes, that the normal legal process cannot speed up. And again, that's the failure of this administration very early, because even though you are one of your core components of your campaign is anti-corruption, to get laws that would aid people like this to get convictions on time. But having said that, I think Magu's problem to me is not really the Senate. His problem emanates from the fact that those who nominated him have left him high and dry. And that to me is a shame. Because like Jide said, this is not the time for the DSS of anybody to now come out and deny that they are aware of a security report. So who made the security report? Who gave it to the Senate? There are fifth columnists in this government. And it's not really something that we should be happy about. He was just a victim of tardiness from the presidency. Because normally, at this level, this is the president's fourth major phase in this government. And if one of the men handling a key pillar of your resolve is being treated like this, then we have problems. Because like I said before this program, we should start building structures and not individuals. And unless the structure works in such a way that ensures that Magu goes, Magu didn't go, we'll still get justice, then we don't need to trouble.
Jide, if we say we are fighting corruption and we are having situations like this where Nigerians are beginning to raise their voices like this person is someone, like you have said, we could say has a clean slate. Where lies our hope in this fight against corruption?
You see, as a young man growing up in Nigeria, I've grown accustomed to good people being destroyed. I saw what was done to Tam David West when he worked for Babangida. Deliberately, Tam David West was cast
set up
as a corrupt person, as a thief. I've seen people of impeccable character presented to the rest of us whenever they fall out of line as dubious people, as indecent people.
Hold the thought. We have Hamzat from Niger State on the line. Hamzat, are you there? Go ahead with your contribution.
Good evening, Mrs. Vero.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Good evening, Baba Jideon. Well done.
Thank you. Good evening.
Nigerians are not surprised with what the Senate has exhibited this afternoon. We'll be expecting this. Everybody know what they are doing. So that they've gotten somebody that will be put into order, they don't want to confirm him. Because nobody wants, because all of us were suffering and they are enjoying it. Now nobody wants to know why we are going, what we are going through. And the fight about to, corruption, nobody, the Senate are not even in support of the fight against corruption. With what they are doing, it has been. Thank you.
Thank you, Hamza. Yeah, you can go ahead.
Yeah, so I'm really not surprised that this is happening to Ibrahim Magu. I know what he went through after Nuri Badu was removed as chairman of UFCC. Remember, they even made attempts at that time to present Nuri Badu as a bribe taker, as somebody who took a bribe from Onanefe Ibori. Whereas when Ibori brought those millions of dollars to Nuri Badu, Nuri Badu made sure that he filmed the money and he sent the money to Central Bank, because he knew in the end they would say he tampered with the money, he took some of the money. So ours is a country where decent people can sometimes be cast as indecent people, as corrupt people. That is what they are trying to do to Ibrahim Magu. Now, Ibrahim Magu investigated the current Senate president. Abubakar.
Saraki.
Abubakar Saraki. He investigated him, and it is the output of that investigation that the Code of Conduct Tribunal is using now to try
him.
The Senate president. So naturally, the Senate president will be excited that this is happening to somebody who presented him to the rest of Nigerians as a corrupt person. So he will be happy. He would not be eager to have this guy confirmed. Look at the time that it has taken. And don't forget, I also want to believe that some people have been working on the president, trying to get him to dump this man, because it is the delay in having having the president even write to the Senate. Remember, it was the vice president when the president was on leave. It was the vice president that actually wrote to the Senate. You know, and that some people were not happy at that time. They felt, oh, that he was trying to usurp the president's powers. But the president was not in the country, and he had gone on leave at that time. So it was well within Oshibajo's powers at that time to do what he did. But even at that time, we didn't have the whole process was not ramped up, because there was still this attempt to ensure that this guy did not become the FCC chairman in substantive capacity. Now, the president whom I have watched for years, whom I used to visit, as I always say on this program, as a young journalist, I want to see how, what he will do in the coming days, because what he does in the coming days will now show to me whether he has chosen to align with a clique within the presidency, because there's a clique within the presidency that I have every reason to suspect is working with some elements in the Senate to ensure that this guy doesn't get confirmed. Now, if the president will behave the way Obasanjo used to do in those days, because Boris Shade, as minister, was rejected. Obasanjo kept sending his name until they left him alone. So if the president is convinced that this is the person that he wants, that this is the person that he can find, because the success story of even Nuri Badu that we talk about, this was the number one investigator in that team. Magu was the number one investigator in the EFCC team that No Ribadu put together. So if the president, so he has experience about how the job is done. If the president is convinced that this is the person, the best person for the job that he can find, it may not be the best in Nigeria that he can find, but this, if he's convinced that this is the best that he can find, then he should just ignore the Senate. Let this guy continue to work. He's a patriot if he loves his country.
Can he really ignore the Senate?
He can. He can. He will just leave him in acting capacity. And he can continue to function in that capacity. But if the president goes ahead quickly to nominate another person, it will signal to me and to other perceptive Nigerians that the president is working in sync with the people who do not want
him to succeed.
Want him to win the corruption war, and who do not want Magu.
All right.
To do that job for him.
We have a caller on the line from Lagos. Are you there?
Yes, I'm here with you.
All right. Go ahead with your contribution.
Yeah. God bless you.
Thank you.
Yeah. What is here now is that we are aware of what is happening in Nigeria. I'm from northern part of Nigeria, but I live in Lagos.
Okay.
Yes. The truth of the matter is that it took Buhari time to appoint ministers. As I said, the people here that are very close to him and those who will work for him. Now, what we are seeing now is eroding of Jonathan's government. He is totally in opposition of Jonathan's government, and we are watching, the whole world is watching, and there's no way I can support sectional fighting of corruption. And from Northern Nigeria, we don't sleep because of foreign investment, and he is following people who are opposing his government. Let me tell you, there's one thing where Trump said. Trump of America said he succeeded because people criticized him to him. That's why he went back and reinforced. Buhari or Africans fight those who oppose them. And so I want Buhari to go and think, as far as I'm concerned, there's nothing on the government to support a foreign man.
All right, thank you, Bami, for your contribution.
Well, it's very specific.
Well, Shola, we have to move on, but quickly, I need to get your final take on this topic.
Well, it boils down to, a lot has been said about corruption fighting back. This is what we are seeing. Is the presidency serious about really stamping its foot on the corruption battle? Then we should be able to see something concrete coming up on this. They should not be railroaded into just agreeing to what is happening at the National Assembly.
GKB?
Magu is not going anywhere. Just grandstanding.
All right, Chidi.
Well, I hope the president would live up to his reputation. I hope the president won't pander to the selfish schemes of some people around him.
Right.
People have already spoken about what these people are doing. Even his wife spoke about some people around him trying to make him fail. The Emir of Kano, the former CBN governor, also talked about some individuals. And one of the closest Nigerians ever to Muhammadu Buhari, Buba Galadima, also spoke about the fact that there are some elements within the president who are extremely selfish, who are doing their best to make sure that he fails. Right. So long as their own nests are feathered. So, but I want the president to retain Ibrahim Magu in acting capacity. He's a patriot. He will do the job in acting capacity.
All right. Well, when Journalist Hangout returns, President Buhari presents 2017 Budget of Recovery and Growth to the Senate. Details after this break. Stay with us. It's your Journalist Hangout, and now President Muhammadu Buhari has presented a proposed 7.298 trillion naira 2017 Appropriation Bill to the National Assembly. It is tagged a budget of recovery and growth. President Buhari says it is structured to take Nigeria out of its current economic woes. The Ministry of Power, Works and Housing gets the biggest chunk of the pie. An eye-popping 529 billion naira is allocated to the ministry. It also earmarks the 262 billion naira for the Ministry of Transportation. Other sectors also have a fair share of the budget. One will be quick to say this is another visionary masterstroke by this administration. But that was the same commendation that the 2016 budget of change got when it was first presented. It is tagged a budget of recovery and growth. President Buhari says it is structured to take Nigeria out of its current economic woes. The Ministry of Power, Works and Housing gets the biggest chunk of the pie. An eye-popping 529 billion naira is allocated to the ministry. It also earmarks the 262 billion naira for the Ministry of Transportation. Other sectors also have a fair share of the budget. One will be quick to say this is another visionary masterstroke by this administration. But that was the same commendation that the 2016 budget of change got when it was first presented last year. Sadly, the story of corruption and poor implementation clipped its wings. And many Nigerians wonder what the budget of change changed about their fortune. Will the 2017 budget make any difference? Shola, before you answer that question, would you say that the budget was well conceived?
Well, on paper, it looks so. But you know, we've been giving a lot of white paper fantasies in the past. And I don't want us to bandy about the issue of figures. You just seen figures. But is there the spirit behind this? You may be talking of 529 billion. It's just figures. The right implementation. Do we really have the spirit, the capacity to really take this up? Yeah, on paper, they look good. But a friend was just talking to me that you have come with your, he used the word white paper fantasies. For how long are we going to have to be dealing with fantasies? So the government should be able to let us know right from day one that it is serious about this. Is it the same vicious circle of words without action? Or are we going to begin to see? And then do we really have the kind of funding to be able to really go through this? So those are the things they have to look at and so then be able to come.
If I'm hearing you correctly, it is seeming like you are not positive that this budget of change, of recovery.
You know, rather, just mentioned what happened last year. But, you know, with the benefit of doubt, let's still see that this government, knowing that so far Nigerians are not convinced about its seriousness, about moving, you're talking of budget of recovery. We have not been able to see any sign that you are really ready to recover the country because we are not seeing the spirit, really, about a serious government taking the country out of economic recession. Now, you know, even right from the day he announced the budget, there are a lot of criticisms already coming up. Yeah. People from different sectors in education, some lecturers coming up that there is not enough.
About
you know, because
education.
If you look at the issue of the kind of capital budget, I mean capital allocation to education, I think about 50 billion to just capital projects. And what they've been saying is that they didn't have enough in terms of facilities to be able to carry along their educational plans, universities, the kind of things they need to be able to have the kind of education required by Nigeria. So that, as the days go by, there will be a lot of issues to be raised when you now look deeper into the different facets of this budget. But the most important thing now is the for the government to convince us that we are not going back to the past. We want to move forward. We want to see real recovery. And then is there the spirit to be able to achieve this? That's what we're here to see.
GKV.
Well, the budget is premised on three factors. Basically, infrastructure, agriculture, and production. Which of course is the joke of the year, because we produce nothing, especially in this country. I can live with the agricultural elements, because it's time that we stop importing food at the level that we are doing. And the money, if you put the money in transport, Fashola's money and MH's money, together with the call special fund, 150 billion, we are looking at about a trillion naira out of the 7 trillion budget. That's massive. But even with that, you know, I wait for the budget minister to tell me what the special intervention fund is meant to achieve. Because if you are giving education money, because you bring down all these monies that we think is massive, there are three ministries under Fashola, and they got only 525. That's average about 180 per Prime Minister. Remember, it's not only for capital projects, it's also for recurrent. And most of that will go to civil servants who are less than 3% of the population. Don't also forget that if these monies are basically meant for infrastructural development, there are only about 5 or 6 construction companies in Nigeria. And most of them have what they call latent workforce. So we are not really bringing new people into the loop, as it were. Julius Baja, Downtown Sangoe, basically have their own staff. Some they will lay off when there is recession. Hmm. When this money comes, they will bring them back. And we are talking about moving around the same circle. No new entry into the production process. Three, there's really nothing about small and medium scale industries. The incentives for them are not there. You keep talking about bringing back textile companies, bringing back silos. But we've been in government for 18 months. There has been no law, not one, that has been forwarded to this assembly to protect local industries. Not one, to protect local production. And to what they are even calling production are basically assemblage of things that you import, which one that Jonathan was basically how they steal money from the system. And you are continuing the same process. Somebody said he's making a car, and 95% of what's using that car is imported. That means no matter what you say, 5% are only the local contents. There's no law forcing them to move up. There's no law from this government telling us elements to use when there are elements that we're looking at goes beyond the UK. So what's my own problem is this. I have nothing against the budget. It's just on paper. What I have against it is this. 1 billion of infrastructure, how will it trickle down to the common man? 1 billion in the current. That, of course, in a situation where all over the world, people are cutting back on workforce. And you are taking 4 billion on other elements that we cannot really fathom. Because they are basically for things that we don't need as a growing country. Water resources. You are building new dams. What happened to the dams you already have? We have about 46,000, I have about 46 dams. I have about 720 rivers. Yet, you still have problems of potable water in this country. So when people give me paper, I look at it. But when you look at their record in the last 18 months, I'm not really impressed. And I'm not really hopeful.
Chidi.
Yeah, I think that if you recall what I said the day President Buhari presented the last budget, you see that everything has come to pass. I said, naturally, Nigerians are always excited when it's time to present the budget. Well, at the end of the year, what do we see? The budget does not really get implemented.
Oh, but I don't think Nigerians are actually excited at this one right now, because from the previous budget, they are wondering, the budget of change, remember, how much change did they make on the common man?
I remember that day, because of the size of the budget, people are saying, oh, this budget better than what happened during Jonathan, that the president also released it early. But what did we see? Arguments about pardon and the rest of them that effectively showed to us that the last exercise was a waste of time. So, and when you look at what the last budget sought to address, the problems that the last budget sought to address, you will see clearly that those problems remain.
If you could just hold the thought, we have Lawrence from Ogun State. Are you there, Lawrence?
Yeah, I'm there.
Go ahead with your contribution.
Yeah, I greet Mr. Abajide Toluju and
right.
The other panelists. My name is Lawrence. I just want to comment about rejection of Ibrahim Magu. This should not be a surprise to Nigeria, because the National Assembly presently we have now, exactly the Senate, both the APC and PDP, they are not for Nigeria. We shouldn't bother ourselves. We have 170 million Nigerians. If they reject Magu, if Buhari cannot source for somebody SPK, is to allow Magu to continue act as an actual ESP chairman on his tenure. This present Senate, both APC and PDP are not for Nigeria. They can never support corruption. They will only united. Anything that is against, anything that will support Nigeria, will be united. But anything that will pay for their pocket, they will cooperate. Right from day one, they didn't support corruption. But if Buhari wants to find his name, he will continue using Ibrahim Magu as an acting TSC chairman. And the man at the middle, I disagree with
Lawrence, thank you for your contribution. Thank you, Lawrence. Yeah, you can go ahead, Julie. You know,
so what I'm saying is, if you look at some of the problems that the last budget sought to address, those problems remain. You can't tell me that the last budget was able to solve a specific problem. So why should I be excited about this one? I will never be excited about the size of the Nigerian budget, because even the size of the Nigerian budget shows clearly that we are a backward nation. Because here in Africa, other countries, the size of their budgets is a lot bigger than ours. It just shows that we are still, in fact, we've not started as a country. Well, the point that I want to make is that, look, there is hunger in the land. Yes, the president has said that this is the budget that will take us out of recession. If I believe that, then I will believe anything. The current budget will not take. I'm not a doomsday prophet, but I would rather die than not say the truth. This budget will not take us out of recession. I'm even wondering where we want to. The funding of the budget is a big problem. Where are we going to find the money? Look at oil is nearing $60 a barrel now.
$50.
Yeah, it's nearing 60 a barrel. But the problem in the Niger Delta continues.
Yeah, well, the
government announced recently that it lost 1.5 trillion on account of sabotage. But we have refused to address the problem. Today, the president suggests that he's going to make peace with these people so that the bombings can stop. But you just see clearly that he's not going to talk to them. And you send 3,000 soldiers and 4 warships to that part of Nigeria. It has not stopped the bombing. Rather, the soldiers are even sinking, and it's militants that they are supposed to kill that are saving their lives. So the thing is, how do we maximize the potential that we have?
All right, we'll answer that question when we return after the break. Stay with us. You're still watching Journalist Hangout, and we are looking at the 2017 budget. Before we went on the break, you posed the question, how do we maximize the potential that we have? How?
Yes, oil, for example, more than 80% of our earnings come from oil. And we are saying that, look, if we continue to suffer the sabotage of our oil installations, oil assets, at the rate it is going, then even if oil goes to 100 per barrel, we will not be able to benefit.
So the 5 trillion naira
that must address the problem. That's the point I'm making. So the 1.5 trillion that you lost, you can imagine earning it. That's substantial.
Okay.
So the president must address that problem so that we can earn more. This is not, he shouldn't try to play the macho man or the military. No. When you need to negotiate, you must negotiate in the overall interest of everyone. That's what the Colombians are doing now.
I'm going to take a cue from GD. The Niger Delta is very essential to this budget.
To the success of this budget?
Now, you know, there is a kind of, people are already talking about even the kind of figure.
Yeah, that was being allocated to the Niger Delta.
Yes. We have Niger Delta Ministry has 33 billion. Mm. The NDDC has 61 billion. That's 94 billion together. Then FCT has 37 billion. Already Niger Delta, some friends from the Niger Delta complaining that you are serious about the Niger Delta, because that's the milk cow from which the nation milks, resources. And you are now allocating 94 billion in this present budget. And you want to create an impression that you want to get that place, pacified. That what they feel is in the budget is not even enough to show that this government is serious. So what are we really feeling from this? Is it still going to be going back to this that kind of circle of disagreement and all those things? But that means the government, looking at the budget, but anyway, in the coming days, we'll be able to look at it deeply. We may have 7 trillion as the superstructure, but all those little details, are they really going to really help us getting this kind of recovery government is talking about? So that's one aspect. Then we're looking at the issue of even the special intervention fund. We have something like 500 billion. Maybe about 150 billion will go to capital spending on that. Then the remaining 350 will be for school funding, economic empowerment program, this Empower. How are these things going to really be implemented that it will not become another opportunity for some government officials and their cronies to now line their pockets? Those are the things they have to look at.
Companies they no longer have interest.
So we have the we have
no longer
paper,
have interest, but they are still signing.
With all this, even now, we have a situation where we don't
checks.
Even have. We don't have an EFCC, because since we don't have a head, it's like the EFCC is like a head,
a
body without a head now.
Oh, you see,
so all these things that, it's like people are just preparing the nation for another, I will continue to use that word, vicious circle. So the president must know that he has a lot on his neck. And he has to really convince the nation that he's really serious about this.
And Chike, we need to wrap up this topic.
Like I said, my disappointment with the broader administration started very early. And I have not been disappointed again. Because this government has no roadmap that can work. It's like giving a Ferrari to a driver who last drove a 504.
Or a ladder.
He's going to drive you to the gutter.
Ladder.
It's unfortunate because there are so much.
504 is more modern than ladder.
Are you in Russia?
You end up in a ditch. You end up in a ditch.
The signs were there. You saw the signs very early.
Yeah.
Now they couldn't form even core economic team for 9 months. You know, we failed. But we write this out. Nigeria is like what Yoruba call Ekpagbo. Always dangles.
But it won't fall off.
All right, Chidi.
It not fall off.
Amen. All right.
The budget ritual, we pass through the budget ritual again this year. My prayer is that we will all be alive to also pass through the same budget ritual next year.
Amen. Well, moving on June the 21st, the Economic and Financial Crimes Commission, that's the EFCC, froze the personal accounts of Governor Ayodele Fayoshe of Ekiti State and those of some of his associates, all for suspicion that there were proceeds of crime. Today, the rhythm has changed. The High Court in Ekiti State has ordered the EFCC, that's the Federal High Court in Ekiti, has ordered the EFCC to immediately unfreeze his accounts because the entire exercise did not follow due process. Did the EFCC goof again, Shola?
Well, one thing is, I wouldn't really know in the sense of the fact that this is a governor under immunity, because some people are saying that, okay, is the issue of immunity really limited in support, or it is total? Because that's what I find. Can a governor under immunity be investigated?
Yeah, that has been settled.
It has been settled. Then on that note, if it also boils down to the seriousness that we're talking about, perhaps the EFCC has not really done its own work to be able to at least cross all the
since June, G's. It should have been able to achieve
that
something.
Is well, what the you know, said.
So it's when you have such laxities, then this kind of outcome will always be there. And I can see the governor now dancing around Ekiti and taking advantage of that.
So that by the time,
by the time they get back to the courts, the old money will have gone.
No, the thing is, you know, the speculation was that I had billions in the account.
Yes.
The EFCC enjoys the media trial that a lot of our people, some editors enjoy it. Get the account of the EFCC and you get a front page news. You are excited. You won't even bother to go to the individuals concerned.
Logic has gone out of the window.
Yeah, now it's affecting all facets of our life, media, work, and all that. Now, what the court is saying is that, or what the court said, was that the EFCC did not get an order of a court to freeze the account. He just took that decision.
Just went to the bank.
Now, if that was exactly what happened, it means that the EFCC never learns from its mistakes. You know, I've always said on this program that I'm never excited when the EFCC picks big people. I want to see whether they will do due diligence. Most of the time, they don't do it. That's why those politically exposed persons usually escape conviction.
But can we say it's deliberate?
I wouldn't know. I think sometimes they are over-excited. Hmm. Okay, look at, let me give the example of Abdulaziz Muritalan Yako, who is a senator now, the son of the former governor of Adamawa State. They lost a similar case to him, and the court awarded 12.5 million against them. Every time I remember that, something told me that it could happen to Fayose. They detained him longer than necessary.
Yes.
Before taking him to court, they froze his account for 2 years without getting an attachment from the court to proceed with that action. So you cannot, the FCC, yes, you can freeze people's accounts, but you must first walk up to a court and get a court to give you the all clear to do that. That is the thing. And what the court is saying is, look, Fayose, as someone who enjoys immunity, no court proceeding. Can take place against him. Mm-hmm. As long as he has, because this matter is in court now. So that means court proceeding is on against him. So the man, funny as he's always been, he went to the bank today, withdrew 5 million, and he made a show of it. Pictures of him.
He's coming back tomorrow.
Until you get, the EFCC said they were going to appeal. I don't even know Abdulaziz matter.
What can that achieve for them?
No, at least if you appeal, they can stop the execution of this thing. But before then, he will have withdrawn all the money and put it in a different account. Because what he wants to do is, he's angry with Zenith Bank. No doubt about it. You know, if he has his way, he will run them aground. So what he's trying to do now is, okay, all that I have left, let me take all of this money, move it to a bank where I can trust.
That understands me.
You know? And he said all that he has in those accounts amount to about 300 million. And he challenged the FCC, publish my bank statements. But the FCC have been enjoying people say, oh, he has billions in the account. The man said, I have only 300 million.
Now, that's my question, GKB. Why is it taking them so long to, if they have had cases like this, why are they not learning from it to ensure that they follow due process?
No, they enjoy the media adulation. It's the only thing I see here. I started from the day of this skinny man, Ribadu. They come to the public and tell you fantastic tales that any school child with enough sense to logic will know it is not true. Because if you are saying a man stole, like example of one governor, and he stole 7 billion, and the entire budget for the states for that year was 3.5 billion, and you wonder whether I was manufacturing the money again after stealing it.
Maybe how they meant.
And then you wonder how can anybody with common sense. But like you said, the media is done. We are just waiting for the undertaker.
If you listen to some of the judgments against the FCC, you see judges abusing the FCC.
No, the level of that incompetence is appalling.
No serious work was done.
Nothing.
Sometimes they have one. You know, sometimes they just rely on a petitioner, and when that petitioner is compromised, and the petitioner stops coming to court. Remember, even Femi Fanikao, this case.
Yes.
How did Femi win? The only witness that the witness recanted. Said, no, everything that I
said was under duress.
Everything that I said, no, I didn't mean it. He recanted. And that was how they lost the case. So many cases like that. Then, if you find money, humongous money in someone's account, you can't say that, you must prove that that money is a product of money laundering. You can't just conclude that that money must have been stolen. That was what happened in the case of Hassan Lawal, the former Minister of Labour. And the judge said, look, you have not proven to me that this money is a product of money laundering. You must prove it.
So could this be part of why the Senate is not confirming?
No.
That's a different
The EFCC itself has, a part to play in this. When I used the word, I asked Jide whether was it deliberate.
Some of them could be deliberate.
Yeah, but some
just why is it that, that it is the 419 guys? Okay. It is the boys who do that are easier to convict.
I intend to know. We have just five seconds to
why is it the politically exposed person? How many of them have been convicted? I can list up to 10 of them that have walked away free.
I will take that as our final text on this matter.
I think that one is inclined to think that some people could actually, from within the FCC, be sabotaging some of these cases.
Yes.
These people have planted their own people inside the system.
Of course.
All right, gentlemen, thank you for coming on the show today. But that's all on Journalist Hangout. Join us tomorrow for another interesting episode of the program. Watch the repeat broadcast tonight at 11. You can also watch Journalist Hangout on YouTube at youtube.com/TVC News Nigeria. Our feedback channel is Journalist Hangout at tvcnews.tv. I am Veronica Danipoe. Bye for now, and God bless Nigeria.